Hi, welcome to the 7th episode of Curiosity, the weekly science program, summing up the developments in week number 24 to 27th of 2020. As usual, this week's episode features stories across the discipline. As you can see in this diagram, the tool used in Dolphin, this is the story of the week or the picture of the week, you know. So how the dolphins make use of the tools like the seashell, you know, the snail shell that you can see in this picture. And we also cover autistic burnout syndrome and then a far UVC light, to sterilize the atmosphere, sterilize the air for the coronavirus. Economics of early childhood education, neural plasticity, and so on. Plus observances in the next week, including astronomy-related observances and opportunities for the students, including PhD, postdoc, and grants. So please stay tuned. Our first story of the week is a paper published in the journal Current Biology last week. The title of the paper is Integrating Genetic, Environmental and Social Networks to Reveal Transmission Pathways of a Dolphin Foraging Innovation. As you know, the tool usage is not that very common, but still reported amongst the animal families. For example, the chimpanzees, the apes do use, the twigs for fishing the termites, isn't it, out of the haunt. So this kind of phenomenon are reported, but still from the marine mammal, especially the dolphin, there are not many reports. You know, of course, there are reports, but relatively it's a rarity. So this is a paper by a UK, Swiss, German and Australian team. And they actually looked at 1,035. Out of this many number of the dolphin sightings, they found 42 times something called shelling events. As you can see in this figure, the dolphins make use of this kind of giant snail shells for fishing. It's very interesting, ankling behavior of the dolphins. So how do they do that? They use these snails, the shell of the snails, and they look at that, and when the fish is trapped inside it, they pluck it and bring it to the surface. The snail shells are, they are in the bottom of the sea, isn't it? So from there, they pick up, they bring it to the surface, and then they vigorously shake it to their mouth so that all the fish is ingested into their mouth. It's very interesting. As you can see that the dolphin has opened its mouth, and it is actually taking all the fish from the shell. So you can also see some epiphytic, the seaweeds attached with that snail. And by the way, this kind of giant snail shell itself is a curiosity, isn't it? I was not aware that this is really common in world's oceans, So these dolphins are something called bottlenose dolphins. So these dolphins at Shark Bay in the Western Australia make use of giant snail shells as a trap for the fish. So they bring these shells back to the surface, shake vigorously to dislodge the fish into their mouth. Very interesting behavior. So it's only second ever instance of a tool used in marine mammal. So first was in 1997 when the dolphins were found to use marine sponge as a protective face mask while foraging the seafloor. Its beak, the protecting something like a socks or a glove. The sponge is being used while they forage on the, when they rub their beak in the sea, the deep bottom, the seabed. Very interesting behavior that too. So in 2011, heat waves at the Shark Bay resulted in mass death of marine animals, including giant sea snail. So see, now the dolphin is making use of that leftover snail shells for fishing. Very interesting. So new study found that the dolphins learned this tool used from the friends horizontally. That's the catch of this study published in the Current Biology. So instead of vertically, that is from parents to, the offspring, that generational learning that is very common among the animals. But here they're learning from the friends. The horizontal learning, as you can see in this graph, majority, this is basically the y-axis is relative support. The x-axis is all about the network. So where they are learning this behavior. So as you can see, it is mostly these are socially acquired behavior, not from the environment or social plus environment, social genetics, asocial genetics. All these are secondary or not that very important, but majority of the learning happens via social, that is from the friends. Very interesting study. Our next story of the week is concerned with this statement by our own Mahatma Gandhi: civilization is the encouragement of the differences. So how open are you to the differences, you know? So this is the paper published in in the journal called Personality and Social Psychology Bulletin last week. The title of the paper is A Privileged Point of View: Effects of the Subjective Socioeconomic Status on Naive Realism and Political Division. It's by a US team, and they analyzed 2374 people, you know, and they analyzed something called naive realism in the privileged population. So privileged means socioeconomically privileged class. How much naive realism they are following? What is this naive realism? It is the worldview that one's own positions are objectively true, while anyone who disagrees is uninformed, irrational, or biased. So, you know, your tolerance for the disagreement is very less, you know. So what kind of people are more prone to this naive realism? That is what the study analyzed, and they found that, you know, subjective socioeconomic status, so people from a higher socioeconomic status are more prone for they are not open for the criticisms. So people of higher status are more likely to think that those who disagree with them are stupid or biased, even when their high status is the result of a random process. As you know, that most of the super rich people are randomly, they became rich. It's not that they were actually striving towards becoming rich. So the findings could help explain why wealthier individuals tend to be more politically engaged than the less wealthy. So even political engagement is also proportional to the, you know, socioeconomic status. So higher status people may be more likely to react more unfavorably towards those who disagree with them, those who criticize with them, and maintain uncompromising positions and have increased willingness to suppress the opinion of others. So if you think yourself as from high socioeconomic status, so, you know, chances are high that you follow this kind of naive realism. So our third story of the week, this story we have already covered in our last episode of the Curiosity, is something to do with Gabrin syndrome, you know. So the risk for the COVID-19 is tremendously high if you have, this kind of men pattern baldness. And the Gabrin syndrome is named after Dr. Frank Gabrin, who unfortunately lost his life fighting for helping the COVID-19 patients in the US. So, of course, the risk factor for COVID-19 varies across the, you know, the population. So this is a paper, published in the journal Lancet Global Health. The title of the paper is Global, Regional and National Estimates of the Population at Increased Risk of Severe COVID-19 Due to Underlying Health Conditions in 2020, a Modeling Study. So it's by an English team, and data sourced from 188 countries. So it is quite exhaustive study which they published in the journal Lancet. So what they found is that an estimated 1.7 billion people, that is almost a quarter, 22% of the world population, have at least one underlying health condition that could increase the risk of severe COVID-19 if infected. So as I told you, one of the risk factor is, you know, the pattern baldness. Of course, there are several other the risk factors as well. So the study also confirms that 4% of the world's population, that is 349 million of 7.8 total number of world population, 7.8 billion people, would require hospitalization if infected. So the finding is tremendously important. So what are the non-risk factors for the COVID-19? Pattern baldness, as I told you, asthma, diabetes, kidney disease, lower immunity, all these are risk factors. Our fourth story of the week has something to do with herd immunity. This topic I have already covered, and if you haven't watched, please watch this video. What is herd immunity and why it doesn't help in COVID-19? I have already covered this in my YouTube channel many weeks ago. And the conclusion of the latest study, which is our fourth story of the week, published in the Lancet, is also exactly same. It's a Spanish team. They analyzed with an enormous amount of people. This is 61,075 recruiters were there in this study. And what they found is that they were looking for the antibodies in their blood, those who were from the places which is really really worst affected in the entire Europe, the Spain, especially Madrid and Barcelona. So the title of the study is The Prevalence of SARS-CoV-2 in Spain, a Nationwide Population-Based Seroepidemiological Study. So seroepidemiological study is all about, the immunoglobulins, that is basically the antibodies in the blood. They were looking at the presence of the coronavirus 2 antibodies in the patient's blood. So what they found is that just 5% of its population has developed antibodies, strengthening the evidence that so-called herd immunity to COVID-19 is unachievable. So, this is just another study. A large number of studies says that this herd immunity itself is not it has no meaning when you talk about COVID-19. So herd immunity means getting an indirect immunity because most others in the society are immune to an infectious disease. It is something like hitchhiking, or it's more an economic process rather than the immunological process. Everybody has immunity, so naturally, even if you don't have an immunity, you are not going to get that disease. But for the herd immunity to be practical, you need a tremendous amount of people to be immune to that disease. Almost two-thirds of the population, 66% should have it, but the study says just 5% have it. So the herd immunity is out of question in COVID-19. But many poor countries who did nothing to fight COVID-19 were hoping that the miraculous herd immunity would come as a solace, the final hope. But this study reveals that that is not the case. For herd immunity to work, at least two-thirds of the population should have antibodies against the disease, got infected and successfully recovered too. And this is kind of okay for non-serious disease like chickenpox or measles. But for COVID-19, it's not possible to talk anything about the herd immunity because COVID-19 is a serious disease. And even if you recover from the disease, you might have lifelong implications, including the neuronal problems as well as renal dysfunction. So many studies are now coming up. We really don't know really the ramifications of patients who got who got recovered from the COVID-19. So herd immunity is not at all a solution for COVID-19 crisis. Our fifth story of the week is about again on the COVID-19 and how to disinfectant, how to disinfect the surfaces as well as the atmosphere. So this study is published in Nature Scientific Reports by a US team from Columbia University. The title of the story is Far UVC Light, that is 222 nanometer, efficiently and safely inactivates airborne human coronavirus. By the way, the term airborne, I have recently ran a story on this airborne versus the droplet aerosol concerned with the novel coronavirus. If you haven't watched it, go please check it out. So this story is about how to actually get rid of the coronavirus from the atmosphere, as it is an airborne disease. So conventional germicidal UVC light, that is 254 nanometer length, cannot be used in public spaces as this is a health hazard. It can penetrate into our cell, the skin cell as well as cornea. So it is not good. Of course, it's a health hazard. No one can do it. But this study says that far UVC light safely kills airborne coronavirus without penetrating into our cell. So more than 99.9% of the seasonal coronaviruses present in the airborne droplets were killed when exposed to 222 nanometer wavelength of the ultraviolet light. So that is safe for use around human beings. So most of the LEDs in the plastic casing that is sold online retailers in the name UVC are not UV. Mind that. So don't get cheated. Of course, after reading this story, you might be wondering, okay, let us install one UVC light in my in the house or in the office space, and you will be checking in the eBay or Amazon. But those are comes in the plastic, the white plastic coated lamps, the LED that claims to be UVC, but those are really not for UVC. So if you really want a genuine for UVC, it usually comes in the quartz casing. So quartz is really expensive, and it's it is quite expensive. The light is not that cheap. It's pretty expensive. Okay, so don't get cheated. And of course, coming to the cheating, there are a lot of things are happening here in India, you know. For example, recently I came across this so-called virus removing card. It's something like a neck band, you know, and if you wear this neck band within 2 meters, you know, all coronavirus will be miraculously decimated. That is the claim. It's absolutely, it's a pseudoscience. Please don't fall for this kind of cheating. Okay, these are the tactic. By the way, the case is actually increasing day by day here in India. So we really have to, you know, use mask and maintain the physical distancing. That is the only answer right now, friends. This is a story published in the India Today few days back. I mean, day before yesterday, to be exact. India might see 2.87 lakh COVID cases per day by February 2021 by MIT study. You know, it is by the Sloan School of Management in the MIT. They published this modeling study in a reputed journal. So they say that this is going to be tremendous if we don't do anything. So the only way to fight the coronavirus disease here in India is to follow the government regulations. Our government is asking all of us to wear the mask. But many people are not really following the government regulations. They go to the public spaces without wearing masks. That is actually a public catastrophe, friends. And by the way, this is another you know, internet meme that I really liked it. So finally, there is some good news that scientists discovered a treatment that can reduce COVID-19 transmission by 70%. And guess what? What is that treatment? And it's just a piece of cloth you wear in front of your foolish face. See, the mask. And that is exactly wearing mask, how much it can actually prevent COVID-19 is the subject of our sixth story of the week. And it has been published in PNAS by a US team. The title is Identifying Airborne Transmission as the Dominant Route for the Spread of COVID-19. So masks alone significantly reduce the number of infections, that is by over 78,000 in Italy from April 6 to May 9. And over 66,000 in New York City from April 17 to May 9. See, wearing mask is really, really helpful for preventing the community transmission of COVID-19. So this is a quote from the paper. We conclude that wearing of face mask in public corresponds to the most effective means to prevent inter-human transmission. And this inexpensive practice, in conjunction with simultaneous social distancing, quarantine, and contact tracing, represent the most likely fighting opportunity to stop COVID-19 pandemic. So, you know, that is a very low-cost solution, but still people are not really practicing it. Another quote from the paper is, our work also highlights the fact that sound science is essential in decision-making for the current and future public health pandemics. So, importance of the science and scientists and public trust on science is highlighted by this study. Rather than politics, you know, we have to trust science and scientists in this pandemic. By the way, this study, one of the co-authors of this paper is Mario Molina. He is a co-recipient of the 1995 Nobel Prize in Chemistry for his role in understanding the threat to the Earth's ozone layer of man-made, you know, halocarbon gases. See, he has completely integrating different kinds of discipline. That is a hallmark of a real scientist. See his spirit. I'm really, really impressed by Dr. Mario Molina. You know, though he's a chemist now, see, he's working with the mask. That's amazing. That is the true spirit of a scientist, a curiosity-driven science. You know, and now coming to our next story of the week is something to do with the environment and climate change. So our seventh story of the week is a paper published in the journal Nature Scientific Data. The title of the paper is Holocene Global Mean Surface Temperature, a Multi-Method Reconstruction Approach. And this is written by a team consisting of US, Swiss, and Germany. And they analyzed 1,319 data points. So it's basically a modeling study, which they conducted with existing data. And as you know, the Earth is right now, we think that Earth is basically after, you know, early around 10,000 years back, we were under a small mini ice age, isn't it, when the mammoths were roaming around. And after that, we entered into the interglacial period, right? So right now, it is basically a warming period, comparatively warming period, interglacial period. But this study reveals something very interesting pattern. It's not exactly warming period, friends. So scientists analyzed over 12,000 years of climate data and found that the human-induced warming interrupted and reversed a long-term natural global cooling period. So right now we were actually going through the cooling period, but because of the anthropogenic, greenhouse gas emissions and climate change, we reversed this trend, and the Earth started warming again. So that's a tremendous impactful study. That is why I picked up for this week's curiosity. So 1319 data records from the samples like lake deposits, marine sediments were collected from 679 sites around the world for this study. And the quote from the paper is that it's possible that the last time the sustained average global temperature was 1 degree Celsius above the 19th century was prior to the last ice age, way back around 125,000 years ago, when sea level was around 20 feet higher than today. So we are really at a very high temperature stage, friends. And this study made use of data from several lines, a very, very interesting study. You can see that the coral rings they analyzed, it is basically a intersection through the coral rings. And they also looked at the marine sediments and insect larval subfossils. They also looked at cave deposits, something called speleotherms, the cave deposit, the patterns of the cave deposit, annual patterns, and they also looked at the lake sediments, the pollen grain inside the lake sediments, the kind of study that people in Antarctica often do. And they also looked at the glacial ice in the glaciers of the world. They also looked at packed rat middens. So middens are basically, the bones, leftover bones, wherever the rats colonizes. You can see a lot of dead bones, dead bodies and disintegrated bones, which later fossilizes. So that is called middens. So they looked at all this data, and then what they found is that, as you can see, that this is, years back, 12,000 years back, it was very low temperature because it was an ice age, and then slowly going up and up, approximately 6,600 years back, when the maximum temperature reached. And from there, the trend is remarkable. It's cooling phase for the last 6,500 years. The world, the planet Earth was actually cooling, only to interrupt around 2 centuries back, that it is now warming. So, or because of the human mediated anthropogenic, the global warming, so accelerated global warming. This graph is alarming, really. It actually shows how much bad we are doing, for our planet Earth. So it is an eye-opener paper, I can say that. So our next paper or next study of the week has something to do with depression. As you know, this is a famous actor, a Bollywood actor, Sushant Singh Rajput, and he has committed suicide, And similar story, recently, yesterday, I read another of the colleague from IIT Kanpur, from computer engineering. He also committed suicide because of the depression. So depression is really common, friends, and depression really need clinical intervention. So this is one of the interesting paper that I found. The eighth story of the week is a paper, published in a journal called Autism in Adulthood. So the title is very interesting. Having all of your internal resources exhausted beyond measure and being left with no cleanup crew. That is what you define the autistic burnout. So that, it is done by a US team. So autistic burnout syndrome, that is what it is. So what is this autistic burnout syndrome? Everybody used to talk before this paper, and it's kind of a subjective interpretation, but this paper objectively identified what actually constitutes the phenomenon called autistic burnout. So autistic burnout is a syndrome conceptualized as resulting from chronic life stress and a mismatch of expectations and abilities without adequate support. So if you look at this definition, all of us actually suffers from this kind of life stress, but some of us actually slip into the territory of what you define as autistic burnout syndrome. you know, when the stress level tremendously increase and there is a huge mismatch of the expectations and abilities without adequate support. So you feel like an imposter and you know, you don't feel like anything doing, so you will be slipping into the depression for a prolonged time. So it's characterized by pervasive long-term, typically 3+ months of exhaustion, loss of function and reduced tolerance to stimulus. For example, activities that earlier you love to do, for example, walking or listening to music or enjoying a nice meal, you won't be interested to do any of these activities, you know, because your tolerance to stimulus has become tremendously low because of this depression, you know, the autistic syndrome, burnout syndrome. So interesting, you know, when I read this story, it's quite interesting that the 3+ month it needs, you know. So it's about how long for a hippocampal adult neuronal stem cell to fully differentiate into a new neuron. So the stem cell to differentiate into the neuron, it takes approximately the same time. So 3+ months is what it takes. So maybe there is a connection between, you know, stem cell differentiation to the formation of the neuronal cell. So that means the differentiation, you know, here happens under delicate conditions and stress can make it impossible to do so. So, you know, if you have stress, then this kind of, you know, the formation of new neuronal cell from the stem cell will not happen. So probably this itself is a natural healing process, you know. So the burnout is a healing response to specific people with autism or similar to neurodevelopmental features. So this is an unanswered curiosity-driven question I have in my mind when I read this paper. So our next story of the week, the ninth story, is also something to do with the depression. And it is published in a journal called Molecular Brain by a UK team from University College London. The title of the paper is Ketamine and its metabolite, that is 2R, 6R, HNK, restore hippocampal LTP and long-term spatial memory in Vistar Kyoto rat model of depression. So they looked at an animal model, you know, so there's something called Vistar Kyoto, and they looked at where exactly the ketamine works. As you know, the ketamine earlier days during the World War time, ketamine is used by the military as an analgesic, you know, and also as an anesthetic. You know, to reduce the pain after the gun wounds, for example, earlier days. So nowadays, ketamine has already been incorporated into the standard regime as a treatment scenario for clinically depressed people. So how exactly the ketamine works, that is what the study analyzed. So accumulating evidence suggests that dysregulation of the neuronal plasticity in the hippocampus contributes to pathophysiology of the depression. So how exactly depression works, so that is what the study looked at it. So study found that, so dysregulation of the neural plasticity in the hippocampus, so that is exactly what is happening in the case of you know, depression. So what is this neural plasticity, the term means? So also known as brain plasticity or neuroplasticity is the ability of the brain to undergo biological changes ranging from cellular level all the way to large scale changes involving cortical remapping to adapt in response to changes in environment or lesion. So if there are some changes, lesion in the sense if you have a brain damage or changes in environment, for example learning process or depression, so you know, this is what is going to happen. So the remapping as well as the physiological change, so that is what you call the neural plasticity. So if this neural plasticity, that is basically, you know, the error correction mechanism is problematic, then that leads to pathophysiology of the depression. That is what we know it. So this study was conducted to explore the antidepressant effect of the ketamine in mice, specifically if the ketamine is able to impart the neural plasticity of the hippocampus. And yes, they found it, you know, so exactly how the ketamine works for the depression, because it helps to restore the neural plasticity. So the result shows that the ketamine was able to restore synaptic plasticity in the dorsal hippocampus of the mice, indicating that it may be able to reverse the stress-induced lack of plasticity seen in depression. So that's a great study. So hippocampus region of the brain and the neuroplasticity are critical for the memory too, not merely for the depression. So memory also is very important. That is why probably, you know, in the depressed people, the memory is also quite problematic. you know. So I would be interested to see the impact of ketamine in recollection, memory and recollection, what is the impact. So probably there is a positive impact because it stimulates the neuronal plasticity. So depression has a non-correlation with poor memory skills, usually seen as a symptom. So usually the starting during the onset of the depression, people lack their memory power. So again, you know, all this has something to do with the neural plasticity, friends. And also for the attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, that is ADHD. Again, that is also, you know, it has a non-correlation with the poor memory, you know. So that is why ADHD, maybe ADHD as well as depression can also be treated. The poor memory function as well as, you know, as well can be treated with the ketamine, who knows. So these are really interesting questions in the curiosity-driven science. Our last and 10th story of the week is from economics. So it's published in Journal of Labor Economics by a Norwegian team, and the title of the study is Head Start and the Distribution of the Long-Term Education and Labor Market Outcomes. Very interesting paper. By the way, what is this Head Start? Head Start is a program in the US Department of Health and Human Services that provides comprehensive early education, you know, early childhood education, health, nutrition, and parent involvement services to low-income children and families. So the study is all about early childhood education plus, you know, other allied services, including health and nutrition for poor family. So does it help or not? That is what the study analyzed. So the children who attended the early childhood education program Head Start go on to earn higher incomes and obtain more years of education as adults than similar children who were not able to attend the Head Start. So the program was really beneficial, you know. They are actually beneficial for the intended target group for which the program started, you know. So the effects are concentrated at the lower end of the distribution, that means economically underprivileged people. And the effects are strongest for women, blacks, and Hispanics in the US. So, you know, that's really, really important. So Head Start benefits those that need it the most. So it's not just an American perspective, but this kind of programs are really important elsewhere too. You know, for example, here in India, we can also have similar programs. Of course, we do have, you know, similar programs, which is actually completely free preschool education, right? Some states do have it. Maybe we need to start it a national, you know, a nationwide new program so we can envision it to help the underprivileged citizen of the country. Coming to the updates from the last week, COVID-19 treatment or vaccine. Coming to the treatment, you know, we have now three candidates in the phase 3 clinical trial. This include Gilead Sciences, that is Remdesivir, Revance Sciences, Gimsilumab, and the third one, that is new one in the last week, that is basically by Regeneron Pharmaceuticals, two antibody cocktails. So all these three things are at, you know, three treatment scenarios are for, you know, treatment for COVID-19. Though none of these are entered into the market, but still, Remdesivir, for example, is now available in India, manufactured by Cipla. And the cost is approximately 4,000 rupees per tablet, you know, Remdesivir. The second one is Gimsilumab, is basically a monoclonal antibody, while the third one is also a cocktail of two different kinds of antibodies. So only these three drugs are now available at the phase 3. Again, this is only at the clinical trial. Now we have one candidate at the phase 2 trial, that is by Athersys Multistem. This is something to do with the stem cell therapy. Now coming to the vaccine, we have got two candidates at the phase 2 clinical trial, Moderna Therapeutics and Sinovac. So Sinovac was earlier in the phase 1, now it has entered into phase 2. That is the development from the last week. And we have five candidates at the phase 1 trials. This include BioNTech, CanSino Biologics, Inovio Pharmaceuticals, University of Oxford, and Novavax. In addition, here in India, we have Bharat Biotech. You know, they are trying their best to develop an indigenous vaccine. So let us hope that they develop an efficient and safe vaccine in due course. Coming to the observance for the next week, July 11 is United Nations World Population Day. for appreciation of the demographics and importance of controlling the world population. You know, that's really, really important that those countries who are, where the population explosion is tremendous, like here in India or China, we really have to curtail the population. At the same time, the reverse is true for countries like Japan, where population is actually going in the reverse order, you know, minus is the population growth rate. So they have to actually increase their population too. So it is a very interesting biased approach. So still, the population is really an important topic. So that is why we are celebrating the World Population Day on July 11th. So July 16th is World Snake Day for the appreciation and importance of the snakes in the ecology, as well as sensitizing the people against the snake bites. So that is a really important day, the World Snake Day. Coming to astronomy related observances for the next week, July 10th is Venus shines at its brightest. So this week we are going to see a lot of planets, you know, the brightest day in the entire year of different kinds of planets. So if you are really interested in astrophotography or star grazing for looking for the planets, then this week is tremendously good for you. So July 10th is for the Venus. July 11th for Mars and Moon get together. So, you know, they both becomes very clear and very nearby, Mars and Moon. July 14th is Jupiter flexes. So it's the brightest day for the Jupiter in the entire year. That is on July 14th. And July 20 is Saturn shines at its brightest. So if you want to spot Saturn, or if you want to take a photograph through the telescope, July 20 is the best day for you. And now this also, this, as you can see, a comet here. So this comet is something called Comet C or 2020 F3. In other words, it's called Neowise. So Neowise comet will be closest to Earth on July 22 and 23. By the way, even on today onwards, I mean, you know, you can see this this comet around the dusk as well as around the dawn. You know, sunset as well as sunrise time, you can see that comet near the horizon. So if you're really lucky, of course, it's a binocular object. You need to have a binocular. Coming to the opportunities for this week, Newton Bhabha Fund PhD placement is open on, and the deadline is 16th August if you want to do a PhD in UK. And AMS DBT Newton postdoc, the 3rd September is the date, the final date again for the postdoc opportunities in the UK. And DBT Welcome Trust India Alliance Early Career Grant for Early Career Scientist, you know, 11th August is the deadline. And of course, DBT Welcome Trust India Alliance grants are for biomedical research. So if you are from biomedical research, you can apply for these grants. And senior and intermediate of the same India Alliance grant, the 30th July is the deadline. So please apply. Next, Japanese government undergraduate scholarship deadline is 17th August, and postgraduate and PhD level scholarship deadline was yesterday, got over, but there is a possibility that these deadlines may get extended, and there is even a possibility that the next may call off entirely for this year because of the COVID-19 situation, and not just next, but also for any of the foreign scholarship scheme, you know. So by the way, I am an alumni of the Japanese government MEXT scholarship. It's amazing. I can vouch on it. And there is a call for an award by the DBT, something called S. Ramachandran National Bioscience Award, which is 200,000. That is 2 lakh rupees. That is a cash award alone. In addition, they are offering a fantastic research grant for 5 years, just like the INSPIRE grant. So the deadline is 15th August. So if you are an accomplished research scientist, who is actually working on bioscience and related field, you may try it out. And there is also a very interesting call for the arts and science. I love this one, the combination of arts and science together. So this is a new call by International Science Academy and CERB, DST, Science Through My Eyes. It's a fine arts competition. If you are good at taking photograph, you know, photography is your passion, then go for it. You can submit your interesting photos or many kinds of arts forms, you know, the fine arts forms, you can submit it. And the last date is approaching 15th July. I hope you enjoyed Curiosity. I will see you again next week. Goodbye.